IVM.
Welcome to All Things Policy, a daily podcast by the Takshashila Institution. We are a bunch of policy nerds based in Bengaluru, and we like bringing fresh perspectives to Indian affairs and Indian perspectives to global affairs. So grab a cup of coffee, sit back, and join us for today's chat.
Hello and welcome to another episode of All Things Policy. I am Pranay and today I have with me Takshashila's China Studies Unit, which is Manoj and Suyash. And before we get started, I just wanted to remind our listeners that if you're looking to transition to a career in public policy, you can come and study at the Takshashila Institution. We offer both graduate and postgraduate programs in public policy. And our applications are now open for the upcoming Jan 2020 cohort. So visit takshashila.org.in for more details and come study on a variety of topics from technology policy to defense and foreign affairs to public policy. Okay, now we'll get started. So Manoj, you had a very interesting anecdote about the National Day Parade. Tell us.
Yeah, so you know, when the 70th anniversary parade was happening at Tiananmen Square in China, everybody was obviously focusing on what sort of missiles are going to be showcased, what sort of drones are going to be showcased. And all of us also focused on those things. But there was this one interesting float among the parades which had
They also have floats like our Republic Day.
Yeah. They have this bunch of floats and they it began with all sorts of military hardware. And then it came to sort of cultural things and important sort of things. And then you had this one float on which you had a lovely, cozy family picture where you had a husband, a wife and two kids. So very hum do, hamare do, playing with a cat. And that was to send a message in more ways than one about China's changing approach to population. Management of the population, given that for over three decades you had the one-child policy. And now this was officially sanctioning on Tiananmen Square with Xi Jinping watching a family with two children happily playing around. Nobody's paying fines. Nobody's being forced to abort. But that just tells you about the shift in dynamics of that society. And I think the data will sort of also bear out that. Right, Suyash?
Yeah. So before we go, that is exactly what we are going to talk today, because this is one notion that has come into being that China might get old before it gets rich. And a lot of articles have been written on that. So we thought we'll investigate this further and we'll talk about this China's one-child policy and its changes and how the future looks ahead. So Suyash, you read a report recently, right? And there was talk about where this fertility rate of China is going, etc. So could you just update us what that says?
So the Economist Intelligence Unit, EIU, has come out with a China fertility report. So it says that, since the time one child policy was introduced in China, initially the child rate was 7.5 per woman. Now it has come down to 1.6 per woman, fertility rate. It was for a very long time, it was hovering around 1.7 and now it was hovering around 1.65 and it has come slightly up in past 2 years to 1.7. So slowly China has realized that if this trend continues, by 2030, 24% of China's population will be over 60. And if it continues ahead, 38.5% by 2075 would be over 60. So if you can see, it is an aging demography and Chinese state is worried due to that. So since past two, three years, they have taken measures to amend this thing. For example, they have withdrawn one child policy. Now they have taken affirmative steps to second child. For example, if a family is having a second child, then how are they facilitated? For example, insurances. Are they giving insurances? Or there is some economists highlight something called as ART, that is assisted reproductive technology, a medical intervention for second child. But the problems in all these things are the state policy is not percolated to ground level. And that is what economist report is highlighting. Despite of affirmative measures by the state, it is not going to the ground level, and which is resulting into slow sluggishness in increase of strike rate.
Right. So, thanks. Basically, what it says is that fear is all too real about the fertility rates going down, and the fertility rates going down are probably going down much faster than the most pessimist of the estimates that we had earlier.
Yeah.
So, but Manoj, let's discuss, why is this a problem? Why should we care about this?
So, I mean, for the Chinese, it's quite straightforward why you're going to care about this, because you've got firstly a very large population, 1.4 billion plus people. As the years go by, that number will shrink a little bit. There's estimates about how over the next couple of decades it'll come back to about 1.17, whatever. But irrespective, you've got a large population, a large aging population, an old population. So if you're at about 33% of the people in the country, 35% of people of the country are retired, aging, you need to take care of them. Technological advancements, medical advancements will mean that these people will live longer. So you need to take care of them for a longer period of time. So you need to have people who are of working age and who are producing, who are creating the wealth that these people will then sort of be taken care of, being taken care of. So your pension systems are burdened, your healthcare systems are burdened, overall labor productivity is going to go down. So as an economy, you're going to slow down. And that sort of poses challenges for a society as a whole as to how do you manage it, not the least from a state finances point of view. But also when you start to then balance and manage all of this, all of these things, there are certain steps that you might take. You might want to invite foreign talent. How do they assimilate in society? You might want to expand sort of marriages, create new citizens. How do they change the social makeup of the country? So there are all these sort of broad things to be taken into account from an economic point of view and from a social point of view. And at the end of the day, despite China today being the second largest economy with a 14 trillion GDP, it's still... this estimates tell you that next year China's median age will be older than the US's. So it's still going to be an economy with 1.4 billion, 14 trillion GDP. When you divide that, it's still far, far poorer than the US. So it is going to be much older, yet be poorer, which is something that they don't want. So it impacts how the state will operate, what is going to be the state's capacity, the power dynamic of the state internationally, and all those things. So therefore, it's extremely important.
Right. So... just to bring this in context, it's not unusual that this is happening in China, even without the one-child policy. For example, in Japan and South Korea, also there have been a rapid decline of fertility rate over the years.
Yeah.
But the thing is that it happened in those countries when their GDP was already settled at a much higher level, much more than what China's is today.
Yeah.
So the impact of that wasn't felt so much.
Yeah.
But in China, it is happening much earlier.
Yeah.
And also exacerbated by government's own policy.
Yeah.
So domestically, like you mentioned, the bigger impact will be one, the pensions and the burden of that. And the Chinese pension system by no means are perfect already.
They're not perfect. And in fact, they've actually... Some of the estimates will tell you, and these are estimates from the Chinese Ministry of Finance itself, where they were saying things like, well, by 2027 to 2030, we could be at a point where we would have exhausted our pensions reserves.
Hmm.
So, and at the moment, I think over the last 2 decades, in 2000, China had, for every retiree or person using the pension system, you had 9 people working. Over the next 20, 25 years, you'll reach a point where there'll be 2.
Mm-hmm.
And that tells you how much of a burden that's going to be on the pension system, which if you're not going to fund it, how are you going to support people more?
Right. And this is an issue which is seldom discussed when geopolitics of US-China is discussed. And I just read a few stats, right? So, for example, there's a great book by Mei Feng on one-child policy, etc. So in that, she says how in a decade... there will be more Chinese bachelors than Saudi Arabians. So remember, this is also because it's a gender imbalance, right?
Yeah.
The one-child policy. And obviously, people preferring male children more than women children there as well. So that has resulted in more Chinese bachelors than entire Saudi Arabia.
Yeah.
And more Chinese retirees than Europe. So it will happen in a decade.
Yeah.
So that is one problem. And the second one, on pensions specifically, when we talk about power dynamics, we often use... the resources approach, right? So China's GDP is high.
Yeah.
It is next to US, so it is the more competitor power, etc. But what we don't realize is that the net power and the net disposable power matters.
Yeah.
Now, and if you take into account that China has to support a huge number of people now, its pension systems are broken, the net disposable power that it has at applicable is quite less.
Absolutely.
So that needs to be filtered in as well. So this has like geopolitical implications. And one more thing I read is that women actually retire much earlier, right? They retire by 50 while the male might retire by 60. So that also has an implication.
Yes. And I mean, just changing the retirement age is a deeply political issue.
Yeah.
I mean, Xi Jinping has not been able to do it despite it being very, very clear ever since he came to power that he sees population, he doesn't see the population, the size of the Chinese population as a burden. He sees it as an important asset. And he therefore wants to sort of have ensure that people have more children, which is reversing decades old dogma in China. Yeah. Yet he's not been able to push this reform through. And even despite the early sort of movements towards altering the one-child policy, I think in 2013, 2014 is when they began this alteration where they said, you can have two children if one of you was a single child. And then they altered it to eventually say, everybody can have two children. That took him 3 years to get to. Two more years in 2018 is when he finally managed to abolish the National Family Planning Commission. Despite that being abolished, there are still fines being levied on people having a third child. There are still registration processes. And people still don't, within China itself, people are unclear whether you can actually have a third child. So there is tremendous ambiguity. Although, like Suyash said, it's not necessarily from the central government. It's about also bureaucratic interests. So this Family Planning Commission is a huge bureaucracy. And it resisted being demolished. And even though it's been completely taken over, officially the nomenclature has changed. It's now a health ministry. Yet, elements of the bureaucracy still maintain power within local governments. And therefore, they believe this is what the state's policy is. And therefore, they go on and implement it. Because there is massive vested interest in all of this. Because the fines that you pay to have more children are significant.
In fact, you're right, Manoj. This report also highlights that in spite of positive action by the state at the central level, it is not percolated at local level. And the fines that you are saying are some way also applicable on the second child in some provincialities.
Yeah.
This is not allowing people to have second child in some peripheral provincialities, which is a big problem for China, right?
Yeah. Actually, it's not at all surprising for me. So let's use this this point to discuss this one child policy in general, how it came into being, and we'll reach today's stage by the end of this. Okay. So, Manoj, when did this come into being? Often people think that it was done during Mao Zedong's time. Was it done?
No, actually not. Mao was actually a believer in, more having more children. He thought that it was good. You have more comrades and you sort of grow. So he saw population as an asset.
Women holding half the sky, heaven, right?
So he, there's a famous quote from him, which I can't recall, but it's essentially, because I don't want to misquote him, but he said something.
Don't misquote Mao.
Exactly. So, but he said something to the effect of, more power because of more people, something to that effect. And although this started to change, I mean, early in Mao's sort of tenure, there was an increased focus on having more children. And then that continued because then you had the Great Famine in the late 50s and early 60s, 61, 62, which is 61 is the point where you actually hit the lowest level of population, some 11 million new births, which is very, very low at that point in time. And then subsequently, again, there was a case of let's have more children. Towards the 70s, this started to shift. So this notion started to shift. And by the time we reached the point of 78, 80, which is when Mao had gone from the scene and you had these new reforms to be initiated, there people saw population as a problem. And this was a discourse that was going on about, well, we have limited resources, how do we divide them? And if we're going to have more people, and these people are not necessarily productive, so how do we end up feeding these many mouths and so on and so forth? And that led to eventually the one-child policy coming into force formally in 1980. But yeah, that was the early sort of discourse around it. So it was not necessarily a Maoist idea. It was much later, and it was driven from the point of view of looking at human beings purely as factors of production and consumption as opposed to actually human beings.
Yeah. But it was first brought in voluntarily for 2 years, experimented by Deng Xiaoping in 2 years. And then in 1980, it was implemented by central government and it took two to three years to get percolated at state government.
So there are interesting things in this, right? First, that debate is still relevant even in today's India, right? Like we are in the midst of this whole NRC and citizen amendment bill. And one of the arguments in favor for this is that India's population is increasing too fast and we should do things whatever it takes to stop the population. That was something similar which was there in the China of that time. So overpopulation and not under governance was seen as a problem. And their idea was that GDP per capita you need to increase, right? Hmm. For that, there you can do two things. One, increase GDP or reduce the capita.
Yeah.
Reduce the number of people. So they said, why not do then why not decrease the denominator?
Yeah.
And that's how it started, right?
Yeah.
And in 1980s. So what you see there is that, again, very mistaken type of policy, because in fact whatever happened in China, the great things happened precisely because it had more people.
Exactly.
And because of the births in 1960s, 70s, you had cheap labor which was available in 1980s.
Absolutely.
And they could do great things in,
yeah,
the economy because that cheap labor in huge numbers was available.
Yeah.
But anyways, we are in the late 1970s, and this prevalent belief was there that we have too much overpopulation.
Yeah.
So we need to control it.
Hmm.
And that's when the government came into with this policy, like you said, Suyash. And they faced the same thing which you were saying, that they couldn't enforce it, right? The union government, no one listened to the union,
yeah,
government, right?
Yeah.
Like, it's just China is as big and
yeah,
the state was quite weak. So no one listened to it. They couldn't enforce all of these things. And then they decentralized it.
Yeah.
So that is one change that did it. And basically they gave targets at local levels.
Hmm.
And that's why you had this vast system where there were different policies. It was not one size fits all approach. So there are some counties had different rules. Some counties you could give monies. You,
yeah,
have conditionalities to have a second child. So this huge expansive system with wide variations of restrictions,
yeah,
mm-hmm, came into being.
Yeah.
Right? So Manoj, did you know who amongst the intelligentsia advocated this reform?
No, I didn't.
Okay. So there is this guy. So this is again from the book, Mei Feng's book. So she talks about a military scientist who was behind
of
this.
Of course. Why not?
So it was this guy called Song Jian.
Hmm.
So the idea there was, by 1980, the entire cultural and this intelligentsia was wiped out,
yeah,
by the reforms of Mao Zedong, right?
Hmm.
So because they weren't there, the only people who were in the corridors of power were the army folks,
yeah,
and the military guys. So this was, he was the guy who was inspired by this idea that you reduce the number of people to increase GDP per capita. And he was sort of the ideological mentor of this idea, which was eventually put forward by the government.
And wouldn't he have thought that 30, 40 years later, he's going to create such problems which are going to be so deeply structurally and difficult to solve.
Yeah.
That whatever the state does, because it's obviously it's much easier to stop people from having children and adopt all sorts of repressive measures than to force people to have children.
Yeah.
That's just never going to happen. It doesn't work with pandas. It's not even going to work with human beings.
Yeah, exactly, right? So this is, in public policy, we call this time dynamics, right?
Yeah.
The impact that a government policy does, its impact will actually be felt many, many years later. And that's why you need to be more cautious about what they're doing. But clearly they weren't. So anyways, this policy came into being in 1980s. And once it was decentralized, there was a reduction in the birth rate as well,
yeah,
right? Then what happened?
Just an interesting, yeah, fact. Song Chiang is also one, hmm, who was the deputy designer of JL-1 missile, the, yeah, submarine launch missile.
Okay.
From submarine to one child policy. See, yeah, where have we come?
See, amazing, no?
So,
he submerged a lot of things,
I know. But it was very, very repressive. I'm sure Mei Feng's book sort of talks about that,
yeah,
the kind of violence that was unleashed, the kind of corruption that the policy sort of resulted in, and the sort of, I mean, that's at one level, right? You know, forced abortions, making people are paying, and you have to take a permit to be able to then have a child. And if you don't have the right documentation, there's a problem. There are stories of obviously, people around sort of these health inspectors, these family planning inspectors going around looking at people's trash to see whether women are menstruating or has the menstruation stopped,
hmm,
to be able to make sure that people don't end up, you know, having children,
yeah,
without being informed. There are lots of cases where people have sort of, pregnant women, when they reached their about 6th, 7th month, whatever, they sort of surreptitiously crossed over to Hong Kong and had children in Hong Kong. I know of people who've had families where, mm, 3 children are Hong Kong passport holders, rest are Chinese passport holders. And there's lots of this that happened. It created lots of social divides and social fissures. And also, the nature of children who grew up, and this is a debate that happens prominently on Chinese social media, right? children who grew up as single children, particularly as China became more wealthy, and this is a conversation that happens a lot on Weibo about, oh, these spoiled single children who got overly indulged and therefore now no longer have social responsibility and things like that. So there was a whole range of impact that the policy had over years. I mean, there's one estimate that keeps getting thrown around. And again, this is very difficult to estimate. But the idea that the one-child policy ended up eliminating 400 million births. Mm. Potential births and births. Again, very difficult to corroborate something like this because you're also proving something that, you know, based on fertility rates, and fertility rates could have changed for multiple reasons over time. But the estimation is that over a period of 30, 40 years, 4 million potential births didn't take place, or even if they took place, there were sort of forced abortions and, you know, fetuses being killed. And that's horrendous. Yeah. That's a horrendous policy to adopt. Again, like I said, it looked at human beings from the point of view of resources, factors, as opposed to human beings. It was dehumanizing.
Yeah. I mean, the huge emotional cost, right? And yeah. We should remember whenever these debates about overpopulation come in India as well. So just looking at some of the emotional cost, right? Again, a few facts on this. So one idea that we don't appreciate enough, just like India, if the government says something, people will find jugaad to just get around it, right? It's similar in China. It's not as if people will just agree because there is one guy, Xi Jinping, telling you to do it, right? It's a big country, diverse country. So there is a term for that called Xiang Banfa, okay, which means literally it would mean a thinking method, but it figuratively actually means workaround. Okay. So there were workarounds which Chinese also adopted, especially in the first phase where the union government said, you do this.
Yeah.
People said, they are not doing this. Right. Yeah. So what they did is, there were fake marriages. So people, only with one marriage, you could have one child, right? Yeah. So you didn't say, I couldn't have two marriages. So people did that. Fake marriages, there were, of course, bribing increased. Then people started buying into the idea that could we have these fertility treatments which gives us twins?
Yeah.
So that then you could have two children and all, right? I mean, now it seems probably, we can take it in a lighthearted way. But just imagine the emotional cost of this.
Yeah.
Just to have a child, you need to have this, need to circumvent this government machinery, right? And then there was one more fact about this concept called Heiheiser, okay, which means black child. Okay, literally it means that. So there are around 13 million such people who are actually undocumented children. Yeah. That's why the word black child. They don't have any hukou because they were born out of this rules. So they were the extra child which was not permitted under this law, right? Mm. And they couldn't find any hukou because you were not literally born, right? Yeah. According to the government.
According to the state, you don't exist.
Yeah. So that exists, right? Yeah. Just imagine again the emotional cost for these people.
Yeah.
Again, we don't talk about that.
Yeah. And also, when these children grow up, they will also have to face number of restrictions from Chinese governments, right? Mm. So, for example, government facilities. Some of the government facilities would not be. They couldn't avail it, right? Mm. If I'm not wrong.
Yeah, of course. So because you don't have a hukou, you can't avail any of these things. So that's a direct consequence.
Education subsidies and et cetera, insurances.
Yeah. And there was this egregious case, Manoj, of this woman called Feng Jianmei. It came into being, I think it was 2012. Again, it's mentioned in the book, but it was a very sad incident, you know. And because basically, she thought that she applied for this conditionality and she could have an additional child. But the government didn't think so. They levied a huge fine on her. And she was from Shanxi province and she was working. So she was not very well-to-do, right? So she basically avoided and escaped. She went from relatives' homes to another relative's homes to escape the government authorities. Finally, the authorities found her. And she was forcefully aborted. And that became a big story because, you know, there was photo of a 7-month fetus lying next to the woman, right? Really, really, I mean, inhumane. Yeah. And that was something which was done. And it actually made a lot of, it was opposed in China as well, right? So such things happened. So anyways, the government realized finally that, you know, the policy that they wanted to do was actually working too well. The fertility rates was growing down. And by 2013, they realized, man, we have been going headlong into the wrong direction.
Yeah.
So now let's reverse it.
Yeah.
And 2013 is where they started relaxing these rules.
Yeah, 2013 is when the first sort of... So this conversation about the need for the policy to be relaxed is dates back to the early 2000s, at least publicly as much as early 2000s. And it took over 10 to 12 years for this conversation to become policy, and even then very gradually. So like I said, when Xi Jinping took power in 2013, when he became the president, that's when I had moved to Beijing. And I remember one of the first conversations that I was having with people was about this, that, oh, we will see some sort of a change in the one child policy. And if you go back and just look, Google news stories from there, you will see this. This is the first conversation. And I think in the end of 2013 is when the first time that he actually announced, I think it's December 2013, that it was announced that we are going to make some change. Now, what that change would be seen. Subsequently, the change was essentially this, that, you know, yes, it is decentralized. People can take their own decisions. But broadly, the idea is that if you are, if as a husband and wife, one of you is a single child, then you can have a second child. In the first, it was if both of you are single children. Then it was even if it's one of you, okay, you can have a second child and you can apply for that. Subsequently, it was eventually abolished. And the reason why this sort of took time is not because the leadership did not realize the importance of doing away with this because of the impact on the fertility rate and this debate about we are going to become old before we become rich, but because the entrenched bureaucracy would not let go. So you have to break these networks of bureaucracy. And look at Xi Jinping's anti-corruption campaign doing some of these things also, where you're taking out some of these networks and you're refashioning the leadership at bureaucracies so that you can then do this. Because from when I used to speak to people in China about this change, they would tell me he has announced military reforms in 2015, 2016. Those are complicated. This is equally, if not more complicated. Yeah. Because the number of interests entrenched in this, given the size and scale, is too massive. Mm. And the bureaucracy will not let it go. And it's evident because in 2016, you did away with the policy. In 2018, you completely removed the entire machinery. The Family Planning Commission was done away with, its history. Yet in 2019, you are imposing fines on people for having a third child. So who's monitoring this? Who's administering all this? And that just tells you how deeply this is sort of entrenched.
Yeah. Well, once you give the government a power and then the interests will align to perpetuate some of these rent-seeking mechanisms, right?
Yeah.
And in fact, after 2013, right? So once these rules were relaxed, it seems only 1/10 of the eligible couples were actually having the second child. So again, it reflects, right? By the time already the people have bought into this idea just too well. And now once your incomes rise, you probably
That's
don't
the
want
thing, right? It's expensive to have children, particularly given that today we have about 58% of Chinese living in urban areas. So cost, you know, lifestyle costs have changed. Education is much more expensive. When they changed this policy for the first 2 years, 2016-2017, you had a spike in birth rates. So I think the first year was about 17.2 million births, new births. The next year was about 17.7, 17.8. So there was a spike. Or maybe the first year was a spike and the second year was a little bit declined. Third year, which is 2018, the birth rate, new births, fell down to about 15 million something, which is the lowest since 1961, when it was about 11 odd million, which I had mentioned. So that tells you that people aren't necessarily biting. And there's probably more subsidies to be offered. The other sort of thing that you can actually look at and say that how this is reorienting society and the market is that over the last 5-7 years, there is a greater increase in investment in elderly care, hospice care, these sorts of things in China. This is now one of the sort of growing markets. And in fact, it's one of the markets that they constantly talk about. We are going to be opening this to the world. Please come and invest in elderly healthcare in China. And that's because this is a big market. So I think these are the sort of trends that you will see going forward.
The Economist also gives an interesting idea. So whatever the steps that Manoj said that China is taking from 2013 till now, it is not matching even the world average, which is 1.8 child per woman, fertility of 1.8 child per woman. So economists came up with this recommendation saying that there are four important things to do for China in future, near future. One is support the local governments. As the thread of our conversation is that despite state taking affirmative measures, it is not percolating down to local governments. So support the local governments in implementation of their fertility policy. Second, that is provide subsidies, provide more clinics in that. Second, support family life at all stages. Third one is breakdown of barriers of ART. And fourth one is removal of limitation of how many children that you can have. So they are proposing that remove limitations altogether. Don't impose
but
a fine.
That's the thing. Because the economics of living have changed. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Even if you remove this now, and even if tomorrow you go and say, nobody will be fine, go have as many children as you want. People will not necessarily have those many children. Also, what has changed is that, again, China's female labor force participation is at 70% or a little over 70%. So more women today are working and working in different fields as opposed to initially in the farms. These women are delaying the decision to have children. So it's going to be far more difficult for them to have more children, more than two at the least. The fact that, like you mentioned, there are 30 million more men than women in China. Another sort of fallout of that is going to be that more of these men are going to look outside China for marriages. The complications of marrying an outsider is one thing. So you'll need to relax certain rules which allow Chinese men to marry outside. This will lead to other problems. For example, we've been seeing this issue with Pakistan for all these women being trafficked into China. These are all outcomes of the one-child policy which have created these imbalances. To correct some of these things, for policy to be able to correct some of these things which have structurally changed is going to be very, very difficult. To be able to get back to the point where you're at least, if not at replacement levels again, which is 2.1. But even to get back to sort of 1.7, 1.8 in world average, it's going to be extremely challenging. Given at the same time, your life expectancy is going to continue to increase and continue to enhance because you're also investing in that. So you're going to be, it's going to be a very, very hard sort of process by which they can come to this point. And I doubt if government policy, how much ever you end up supporting it, will make this sort of transition. Because once society shifts in this way, it's very difficult to take it back.
The way of thinking has transitioned from that time. And that's what the time dynamics thing says, right? Yeah. Now, government can do lots of things, but it's still bearing the costs of what it did earlier.
Yeah.
So now if it expects that by changing this within 5 years, people will change their behavior, it's unlikely to happen.
No, I understand. I agree with all the things that you are saying. But subsidizing education, subsidizing health care for the second child or giving incentives for the second child, I know that it will have a strain on revenue. But if such actions are taken, would 10 years down the line will not have a difference?
It might have some sort of a difference. But think of it like this. Whatever subsidies you are providing, if as individuals you're getting married later, you're having children later, the possibility that you will consider more than two children or even two children are lower. Because if I'm getting married when I'm 30, 31, 32, and I'm having a child when I'm 35, the energy that I need to have, okay, you're paying for the education, the energy that I need to have to bring up the child, and given that I'm the father of a toddler, it is not easy.
I could see you're speaking from experience.
I'm speaking from the heart. Yeah. So I think therefore the decision is far more complicated than just money. But money is a big factor.
But this is not only particular to China, right? This is about career ambitions, which is across
about career ambitions. It's also about the fact that your lifestyles have changed. Mm-hmm. Just the fact that you went from, in India if you take a look, we went from joint families to nuclear families. In joint families, it was much easier for other people to pitch in to support your childcare needs. In nuclear families, you're not really going to be able to do that. So those dynamics have also changed.
Yeah, to answer in short, Suyash, subsidy will have an impact of increasing and incentivizing. It will definitely increase than what it is today. But it's unlikely that it will reset all that deficit. Yeah. Because for that to change, you need a social revolution because people have already bought into a way of life which can't change. And no government, even though it is run by Shi Dada, can change that. So, anything else?
No, I think that's it.
Great. So, I think this should serve as a lesson for all people who think overpopulation is a problem that needs to be tackled in by whatever means possible.
Yeah.
That was our objective of discussing this. Hope you liked it. If you have any comments, please let us know on Twitter. We are at Takshashilines. Thank you.
Thank you.
If you liked our show, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can tune into them on the IVM Podcast app, ivmpodcast.com. or wherever you listen to your podcasts. You can also follow IVM on social media. The handle is at IVM Podcasts on Twitter, Facebook and Instagram. And hey, if you'd like to dive into Takshashila's research on technology, strategy and economic affairs, check us out at our Twitter handle at TakshashilaInst or our website takshashila.org.in.
I hope you enjoyed that show. We'd like to thank our sponsors this week, Intel Storytel and Cambly. And let me tell you a couple of things that you should check out this week. On Football Shootball, Gaurav, Karthik and Siva talk about Jose Mourinho's return to Old Trafford, the Manchester Derby and, of course, FPL. On this Pragati podcast, Prakhar Mishra and Pawan help us understand what state capacity is, how it could be measured and how India can improve its state capacity rapidly. On Geek Fruit, Jishnu and Tejas discuss Rian Johnson's new whodunit movie, Knives Out, and then talk about directors doing their best work between franchises. On Paisa Vaisa, Anupam is joined by Upasana Taku, co-founder of MobiQuick. They talk about the present and future of digital payments in India and the history of MobiQuick. On Paperback, Satyajit and Racheta talk to photographer Meenal Jaiswal, who shares 9 steps of clicking a portrait picture and why we need more women photographers today. On States of Anarchy, Hamsuni talks to Narayani Basu about the process of consolidating 565 princely states into modern India. Thanks and keep listening.
How many times have you caught yourself Googling stuff on health and wondering if it's the right information? How many times have you heard different health experts give opposing views, which has only left you confused? There are rising cases of cancer, heart, diabetes, stress, and autoimmune diseases. Meet the patients and the experts who paved the path of true healing. Join me, Rachna Chachi, cancer nutrition coach and nutritional therapist on Heal and Hearty. I take you through my own journey of recovery from an incurable disease and the journey of so many others who healed only via nutrition and holistic healing. Find the answers you seek for what's good for your health and what's good for your soul. You can listen to us on the IVM Podcast app or ivmpodcast.com. Don't forget your date with good health.